Hello students, this is Vishnu Tande and welcome back to my class. Dear students, in this particular session, we are going to deal with time standard civics first chapter, power sharing. With this chapter, we resume our tour of democracy that we started last year. We noted last year that in a democracy, all power does not rest with any one organ of the government. And intelligent sharing of power among legislature, executive and judiciary is very important to the design of our democracy. In this and next two chapters, we carry the idea of power sharing forward. We start with two stories from Belgium and Sri Lanka. Both these stories are about how democracy handles demand for power sharing. So let us start the class with the story of Belgium. Belgium is a small country in Europe. In terms of area, it's smaller than Haryana. Belgium has boundaries with France, the Netherlands, Germany and Luxembourg. It has population of a little over 1 crore, about half of the population of Haryana. The ethnic composition of this small country is very complex. Here, the term ethnic means a social division based on a shared culture. Ethnic means a social division based on a shared culture. Here, as I said that the ethnic composition of a Belgium is very complex. How it is complex? Here, 59% of the population lives in a Flemish region and speaks Dutch language, and 40% of the people live in a Wallonia region and speak French. Remaining 1% of the Belgians speak German. In the capital city, Brussels, 80% people speak French, while 20% are Dutch speaking. See, it's the map of Belgium, which indicates communities and region of Belgium. So here, the minority French speaking community was relatively rich and powerful. This was resented by the Dutch speaking community, who got benefits of economic development and education much later. This led to tension between the Dutch speaking and French speaking communities during 1950s and 1960s. The tension between the two communities was more acute in Brussels. Brussels presented a special problem. The Dutch speaking people constituted a majority in the country but minority in the capital. So let us compare this situation with another country, Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka is an island nation, just a few kilometers off the southern coast of Tamil Nadu. It has about 2 crore people, about the same as in Haryana. Like other nations in South Asia, Sri Lanka has a diverse population. The major social group are Sinhala speaker, that constituted around 74%, and second one is Tamil speaker, which constituted around 18%. Among the Tamil, there are two subgroups. Tamil natives of the country are called Sri Lankan Tamils. They constituted of 13%. The rest of whose forefathers came from India as plantation workers during the colonial period are called Indian Tamils. So, Sri Lankan Tamils are concentrated in the north and east of the country. Most of the Sinhala speaking people are Buddhist, while the most of the Tamil are Hindus or Muslims. There are about 7% Christians who are both Tamil and Sinhala. So this is a map of Sri Lanka, which indicate the diverse population or ethnic. So now, student, we need to understand another concept here. Just imagine what could happen in this situation like this. In Belgium, the Dutch community could take advantage of its numeric majority and force its will on the French and German speaking population. This would push the conflict among communities further. This could lead a very massive partition of a country. Both the sides would claim control over Brussels. In Sri Lanka, the Sinhala community enjoyed an even bigger majority and could impose its will on the entire country. Now, let us look at what happened in the both these countries. So, let us move to the first one, Sri Lanka. So, now the concept which is very important in examination point of view is the majoritarianism in Sri Lanka. So, Sri Lanka emerged as an independent country in 1948. The leaders of the Sinhala community sought to secure dominance over government by virtue of their majority. As a result, the democratically elected government adopted a series of majoritarian measures to establish Sinhala supremacy. Now, we need to understand the term majoritarianism. What does majoritarianism mean, or what is majoritarianism? So, majoritarianism is nothing but a belief that a majority community should be able to rule a country in whichever way it wants by disregarding the wishes and needs of the minority. Majoritarianism is a belief that the majority community should be able to rule a country in whichever way it wants by disregarding the wishes and needs of the country or needs of the minority. So, dear students, you need to here focus the next concept, the provisions of Act 1956. So, it's very important, examination point of view, it's very very important. So, let us go the one by one, the provisions of the Act of 1956. In 1956, an act was passed to recognize Sinhala as the only official language, thus disregarding Tamil. So, as per the Act 1956, Sinhala was recognized as the only official language of Sri Lanka, and this act disregarded or overlooked the another language, Tamil. The government followed preferential policies that favor Sinhala applicants for a university's position and government jobs. And even here too, Sri Lankan government disregarded the wishes of or interest of Tamil speakers. A new constitution stipulated that the state shall protect and foster Buddhism. It means, so the new government of Sri Lanka that decided to just focus on the Sinhala speakers and just focus on or popularize the Buddhism. All these government measures coming one after the other gradually increased the feeling of alienation among the Sri Lankan Tamilians. So let us see what happened. What are the consequences of these policies, preferential policies or majoritarianism? So now let us understand consequences of the majoritarian policy. What happened? How did the Tamils feel after these policies that followed by the Sri Lankan government, which was totally in favor of Sinhala speakers? So first, Tamils felt that the none of the major political parties led by the Buddhist Sinhala leaders was sensitive to their language or culture. They felt that the constitution and government policies denied them denied them the equal political rights. They felt discriminated against getting jobs and other opportunities and ignored their interest. As a result, the relation between the Sinhala and Tamil communities strained over a time.
We have to come to know that majoritarian measures and preferential policies of Sri Lanka gradually increased the feeling of alienation among Sri Lankan Tamils. Now, let us understand how did the Sri Lankan Tamilians react? What did they do? What were the measures taken by the Sri Lankan Tamilians to gain their political equality and their rights? So, let us understand the concept. The Sri Lankan Tamils launched parties and struggles for the recognition of Tamil as an official language, for regional autonomy and equality of opportunity in securing education and jobs. But the demand for more autonomy to provinces populated by the Tamil was repeatedly denied. By 1980s, several political organizations were formed demanding an independent Tamil Eelam. It means Eelam in the sense state in a northern and eastern part of the Sri Lanka. So by 1980s, several political organizations were formed demanding an independent Tamil Eelam in the north and eastern part of Sri Lanka. The distrust between the two communities turned into widespread of conflict. It soon turned into a civil war. So now we need to understand the term civil war. What does civil war mean? A civil war is a violent conflict between opposing groups within a country that becomes so intense that it appears like a war. So the conflict between the two communities, Sinhala communities and Tamil speaking communities, resulted in a civil war, into a civil war. And civil war means a violent conflict between opposing groups within a country that becomes so intense that it appears like a war. Now, what is the result of civil war? As a result, thousands of people of both the communities have been killed. Many families were forced to leave the country as a refugees, and many more lost their livelihoods. Finally, the civil war ended in 2009. So long civilian war. So let us move to the next one. Here we have learned the measures taken by the Sri Lankans. We learned here how Sri Lanka handled the demands for power sharing. Now let us go to the second story, second aspect. What did Belgium do, or what were the measures of Belgium to sort out the problem between the two communities? So let us understand the concept. Here the measures that is adopted by Belgium was accommodation. So let us go to the Belgium, story of Belgium and the measures taken by the Belgian leaders. Took a different path. They recognized the existence of regional differences and cultural diversities. Between 1970 and 1993, they amended their constitution 4 times so as to work out an arrangement that would enable everyone to live together within the same country. The arrangement they worked out is different from any other country and it's very innovative. Here are some of the elements of Belgian models. So here we are going to learn what are the measures taken by the Belgians or Belgium. So first and foremost, Constitution prescribes that the number of Dutch and French speaking ministers shall be equal in the central government. There is no discrimination. There is no discrimination between the political rights. So it means the constitution given the priority for the equal priority for the both communities, Dutch and French. Some special laws require the support of majority of members from each linguistic group. Thus, no single community can make decisions unitarily. Many powers of central government have been given to state government of the two regions of the country. The state government are not subordinate to the central government. Brussels has separate government in which both the communities have equal representation. The French speaking people accepted equal representation in Brussels because the Dutch speaking community has accepted equal representation in the central government. So these were the measures adopted by the Belgian. Now let us move to the next one. Apart from this, apart from the central and state government, there is a third kind of government. This is community government. This community government is elected by people belonging to the belonging to one language community, Dutch, French and German speaking, no matter where they live. The government has the power regarding cultural, educational and language related issues. Now students, you might find the Belgian model were very, very complicated. It indeed is very complicated even for people living in the Belgian. But these arrangements have worked well so far. They helped to avoid civic strife in the sense quarrel, war, conflict, civil strife between the two major communities and possible division of a country on linguistic lines. When many countries of Europe came together from the European Union, Brussels was chosen as its headquarters. What do we learn from these two stories of Belgium and Sri Lanka? Both are democracies, yet they dealt with the question of power sharing differently. In Belgium, the leaders have realized that the unity of the country is possible only by respecting the feeling and interest of different communities and regions. Such realization resulted in a mutually acceptable arrangements for power sharing. Sri Lanka shows us contrasting example. It shows us that if a majority community wants to force its dominance over other and refuse to share power, it can undermine the unity of the country. Now let us move to the next aspect, why power sharing is desirable. So here, for this we can give the two different states of reasons. So here we can give two different states of a reason. So one can be prudential and second one can be moral. So what does prudential means? Prudential means based on a prudence or on careful calculation of gains and losses. Here prudential reasons stress that power sharing will bring out better outcomes. Moral reason emphasize the very act of power sharing as valuable. Now let us go with the first one, prudential reasons. Here why power sharing is desirable under prudential reason. Power sharing is good because it helps to reduce the possibility of conflict between social groups. It helps to reduce the conflict between the social groups. Since social conflict often leads to violence and political instability, so to avoid these conflicts, violence and political instability, power sharing is the best. So that reduces the conflict between the communities. Next one, B. Power sharing is good way to ensure the stability of political order. In order to keep to political stability, power sharing is best measures. Imposing the will of majority community over others may look like an attractive option in the short run, but in the long run it undermines the unity of a nation. So these are the reasons under prudential reasons which says power sharing is a desirable. So let us go to the second one now. Moral reason. Under moral reason, we can give the following points to justify the statement power sharing is a desirable. Whether power sharing is a desirable. Power sharing is very spirit of a democracy. A democratic rule involves sharing power with those affected by its exercise and who have to live with its effects. People have a right to be consulted on how they are to be governed. A legitimate government is one where citizens, through participation, acquire a stake in the system. So here, students, we have learned the power sharing with the stories of Belgium and Sri Lanka. So in the next class we shall come with another part of this lesson, forms of power sharing. Till then, take care and thank you very much.